Hello, everyone. My name is Richard McSherry. I'm pastor of the Shaftsbury Methodist Church, and I'm joining you from the sanctuary of the First Baptist Church on the corner of Valentine and Main. And we're so glad to be with you today or tonight, whenever you are watching. One of the miracles of television, I guess. But we are welcoming you here today, and we'll have special songs and readings, and we hope that it'll be a blessing to you. Let's go to God in prayer at this time. Almighty God, we come to you with grateful, overflowing hearts for your love for us, your love for humanity, your love for all creation. We thank you, Lord, that you have placed us in this beautiful world to contemplate you, to serve you, and to serve others. We pray that your Holy Spirit will be with us at this time, during this time of worship. For we ask it through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever and ever. Amen. This time, Chris will come forward to bring our special music.
To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy and hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
God's faithfulness is great indeed. And we are turning now to the book of Psalms, to Psalm 50, and we'll be reading that responsively.
The mighty one, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting.
Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth.
Our God comes and does not keep silence, before whom is a devouring fire, round about whom is a mighty storm.
God calls to the heavens above and to the earth, that the people may be judged.
Gather to me my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
The heavens declare God's righteousness, for God alone is judge.
Hear, O my people, and I will speak, O Israel. I will testify against you. I am God, your God.
I do not reprove you for your sacrifices. Your burnt offerings are continually before me.
But I will not accept a bull from your house, nor a he-goat from your folds.
For every beast of the forest is mine, the cattle of a thousand hills.
I know all the birds of the air, and all that moves in the field is mine.
If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world and all that is in it is mine.
Do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats?
Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and pay your vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me.
But to the wicked, God says, what right have you to recite my statutes or take my covenant on your lips?
For you hate discipline and you cast my words before you.
If you see thieves, you are their friends, and you keep company with adulterers.
You give your mouth free rein for evil, and your tongue frames deceit.
You sit and speak against your brother. You slander your mother's son.
These things you have done, and I have been silent. You thought that I was one like yourself, but now I rebuke you, and I lay the charge before you.
Mark this, then, you who forget God, lest I rend, and there be none to deliver.
Those who bring thanksgiving as their sacrifice honor me, and those who order their way aright, I will show the salvation of God. And as we turn to our faithful God in prayer, we want to remember especially those who may be ill today, those who are in hospitals or nursing homes or other health care facilities, and also we want to remember those who have lost loved ones this past week. Let's turn to God in prayer. Gracious God, we do come to you knowing that your faithfulness is great indeed. You are the solid rock on which we stand, a mighty fortress that can never be moved. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for being with us and loving us through the most difficult of times. We do want to lift up, Lord, those who need a special touch from you, those who may be ill in mind or body or spirit, those who may be plagued with cancer or Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or whatever other afflictions they may have. For those who are in hospital, either now or in the last week or so, those who are in kind of a bad way, Lord, we want to lift those people up to you. There are many, it seems, struggling at this time. We ask that you be with those, especially those who have lost loved ones at this time. We want to pray for our nation and our world. We want to pray for peace where there is no peace. We want to pray for reconciliation between all peoples. And lastly, Lord, we want to pray for ourselves. Make us be the people you've called us to be. Through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This time, Sue will come forward again to bring our scripture readings.
And the reading from the Old Testament is from Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, "Do not be afraid, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great." But Abram said, "O Lord God, what will you give me, for I continue childless? And the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus." And Abram said, "You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir." But the word of the Lord came to him again, saying, "This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir." He brought him outside and said, "Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them." Then he said to him, "So shall your descendants be." And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. The reading from the New Testament is from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 11, verses 1 through 3, and verses 8 through 16. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made by things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in a land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he was too old and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these ancestors died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear they are seeking a homeland. If they'd been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. And the gospel reading is from the gospel according to Luke, chapter 12, verses 32 through 40. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Let's turn to God in prayer. Gracious God, indeed, all of the ground is sinking sand, and your word is that firm foundation that we have, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name. That first verse that Sue shared with us from Hebrews. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. Assurance and conviction. These are strong words indeed. To be assured of something that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it's firm and solid. The author of Hebrews uses the word faith some seven times in these few short verses. Seven times. And we are told that faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. What a strong statement indeed. Nothing wishy-washy here at all, but a solid, sure, and hope-filled confidence in Almighty God himself. The kind of faith that stands the tests, empowers us for whatever may come, and gives to us a hope for the future. This is the faith of saints and martyrs who through the centuries have, along with the Apostle Paul, been able to say, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. Fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith. And finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but to all who have loved his appearing. So that promise, that crown of righteousness, isn't just for Paul. This isn't just a personal narrative. It's for all of us. This is the faith that endures, that goes the extra mile and rejoices in the Lord. Someone has said, this definition of faith contains two aspects, the intellectual, assent and trust, and an intellectual assent is believing something to be true. Trust is actually relying on the fact that something is true. And a good illustration for that is a simple everyday object, a chair. Most of us have a chair somewhere around the house. Intellectual assent is recognizing that that chair, four legs and a back and a seat, that chair is in fact a chair and agreeing that it is designed to support someone who sits on it. Trust, on the other hand, trust is actually having the courage, if you want to say that, to sit in that chair. And understanding these two aspects of faith is critical. Many people believe certain facts about Jesus Christ. Many people will intellectually agree with the facts the Bible says about Jesus. But knowing those facts to be true is not what the Bible means by faith. The biblical definition of faith requires intellectual assent to the facts and trust in those very facts. And this is something that each and every Christian must do for themselves alone. Faith and trust cannot be held for you by a third party, as it were. It cannot be held by a spouse or a family member, a parent, even a Sunday school teacher or a beloved pastor, whatever it might be. They cannot hold faith and trust for you. You must have it for yourself. We must each come to that point in our lives where we place our faith and our trust and our confidence in the Lord Jesus for ourselves. There's a story told about John and Charles Wesley. John being the great preacher, they were both pastors, but John being noted for being the great pastor and preacher, and his brother Charles being the great hymn writer. Well, it seems in October of 1735, John and Charles began a trip that took them from England to the state of Georgia as missionaries. And during their third month at sea, their ship was caught in a terrible storm. Waves were breaking over the bow of the ship. It split the main sail in pieces, covered the ship in seawater, and poured in between the decks. A terrible screaming commenced among the English sailors. But the Moravians who were there, these Moravian Christians, began praising God and calmly singing hymns and prayed together. You see, their trust and faith in the Lord gave them that assurance, that blessed assurance, that whatever may come, they were in God's almighty hand. The behavior of the Moravians so impressed John Wesley that he approached Mr. Spangenberg, one of the Moravian pastors, and questioned him about the serenity of these people that were gathered here. He'd never seen anything like it in the face of what seemed to be imminent destruction. They were moved and astonished at their calm demeanor in what could have been a disastrous situation. Well, the pastor said, my brother, I have to first ask you one or two questions. Have you the witness within yourself? Does the Holy Spirit of God bear witness with your spirit that you are indeed a child of God? Numbed by the question, and remember these two, both John and Charles, were duly ordained clergymen of the Church of England. Wesley remained silent. Then Spangenberg had another question. Do you know Jesus Christ? To which he replied, I know that he is the Savior of the world. True, said the German pastor, but do you know that he has saved you? Finally, John Wesley replied hesitantly, well, I hope he died to save me, but his words had a doubtful and somewhat hollow ring to them. Wesley eventually received the assurance of that salvation and the witness of the Spirit. It was later at his famous Altersgate experience when he went in London to a small Moravian chapel and heard the gospel and responded, and the phrase he used, he felt his heart strangely warm. Believing merely in some kind of intellectual fashion alone that Jesus is God incarnate and died on the cross to pay the penalty for sin and was resurrected is not enough, because each and every one of us must personally and fully rely on the death of Christ as the atoning sacrifice for our sins and for us alone. Atonement has often been referred to as at-one-ment, making ourselves at one with the Almighty. You see, we must sit in that chair of salvation that Jesus has provided. This is saving faith, trusting that that chair is solid and secure. The faith required for us salvation is belief that the Bible says about Jesus and what he accomplished, and fully trusting in him for his redemption, his salvation. Biblical faith is always accompanied by repentance. And you know, that's a difficult word these days. We have to say a little something about that word, repentance. Repentance is really a very simple word, repent. It means to turn around, to go in a different direction, a higher direction, a better direction. That's all repentance means. It isn't sackcloth and ashes. It's turning and going Godward rather than selfward. In Mark 1:15, Jesus said, the time has come that the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Turn around, listen, believe the good news. When we come to faith in Christ, we leave behind those things which are displeasing to him, and we embrace an entirely new way of life. When we come to Christ and surrender to him, our lives, our hearts, our inner person is transformed. The biblical definition of faith does not apply only to salvation. It's applicable to the entire life of a Christian. We are to believe what the Bible says, and we are to obey it. We are to believe the promises of God and then live according to those very promises that God has given us. We are to agree with the truth of God's word, and we are to allow ourselves to be transformed by it. As Romans admonishes us, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, God's good, pleasing, and perfect will. God's will is good. It's good. It's good for us. It's pleasing to the Lord. It should be pleasing to us as well. And it's perfect. It's absolutely perfect. God's will for us, for you and me, is perfect. You know, we see a great deal of conformity and compromises and accommodation in this world of ours, even sadly within the church at times. What we need is transformation, alteration, a heartfelt change from the things of the earth to the things of God. Faith is not just some sort of wishful thinking. No, indeed, faith is trusting in a God who keeps every one of his promises. It is a faith built upon the solid rock of Christ and him crucified. It is a faith that stands the test, both for time and eternity. Faith is letting go of self and saying yes to God. Why is this definition of faith so important to us today, here and now, within the hearing, whatever time of day or night you're listening? Why must trust accompany agreeing with the facts? Because as Hebrews 11:6 said, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Faith is trust, and if you don't have trust in God, if you don't have faith in God, you can't please him because you're not trusting him. Without faith, the Christian life cannot be what God intends it to be. And we believe that when we come to the living Christ in repentance, trust, and faith, we are given the assurance that God is always with us. Later on in Hebrews, we read in Hebrews 13:5, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Just trust in him. Our faith is a transforming faith, a faith that seeks that higher ground, a faith that makes us different and better persons. One early 19th century Christian said, moreover, faith is not just a mental agreement, some sort of just assent to something. As the rest of Hebrews 11 illustrates, faith drives action. Begins with faith, but it reaches out. If we believe there is more to life than what we see, true faith, real faith, genuine faith, will drive our values, our decisions, and our actions to align with that belief that we hold. For we are not saved by believing in our own salvation, nor by believing anything whatever about ourselves. We're saved by what we believe about the Son of God himself and his righteousness. The gospel believed saves, not the believing in our own faith. Faith is not, as some would have it, a nebulous sort of thing. It isn't faith in faith, as some people would say. You know, often we hear people say, oh, it doesn't matter what you believe, as long as you have faith. Well, it's quite the contrary. What you believe, or more precisely, in whom you believe, is of the greatest importance. You may jump in your car, for instance. You might want to head to California to see a beautiful sunset in the Pacific. And you could drive and drive and drive as you're heading east. And you know what? You'll hit the Boston suburbs, but you won't hit California. And you'll miss the sunset. What you need to do is to turn around, to repent. That's simply what it means, and head west. In spite of whatever that unknown future may be, trust in the Lord, leave things to him, and move forward with Christ, keeping your eyes on the prize. He will get you there. You see, our faith isn't in something, it's in someone, the Lord Jesus Christ. We can always trust in him. Corrie ten Boom has said, faith sees the invisible, faith believes the unbelievable, and faith receives the impossible. Never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. We don't know what the future holds, but God does. We don't worry or fret about that. We leave it in his holy hands. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. That word for assurance has been translated as substance, confidence, or the reality of something. Originally, the term conveyed the idea of a firm foundation, the real being, the actual existence, and substantial nature, and a resolute trust. One biblical scholar tells us, the sense of the word refers to a title deed or a legal document guaranteeing the right to possess a property. It is signed, sealed, and delivered and handed to you from the highest authority. As we can see, it's a solid thing, a sure thing, something that gives us confidence in the days ahead, whatever the present may feel like. Great faith isn't, as we're told, just happenstance. Observe closely and you'll note various habits of those saints, those heroes of God who have persevered. And those are the habits we too can adopt. To begin with, ask God for more faith. Such an obvious step, so easy to overlook. Yet it's a request God asks of us and delights to fulfill. You do not have because you do not ask, the Bible says. Knock and it will be opened to you. The Lord calls us to seek him more and more every day. It's a growing thing to die daily, to grow each and every day, and affirm the truths and the promises of the Bible. Soak up its wisdom, examples, and encouragement each and every day. And pray about everything. You know, sometimes we think, oh, that's a little thing. I'm not going to pray about that. And just keep the big things for God, right? But pray about everything. It helps to ward off the worry. Write down your requests and leave room on your scrap of paper for the answers. As visible evidence of God's faithfulness increases, so will our faith in him. It grows and grows. It's nurtured and watered. Our faith is a growing thing. This is the faith that will carry us through because it is the Lord Jesus who has also walked this path and who has endured shame and rejection and the cross and even the grave and ultimately an empty tomb and did that for our behalf. We find in him that friend who sticks closer than a brother through thick and thin. One author states, God's abundant goodness, God's miraculous works, and the sacrifice of his Son, Jesus, for our salvation, gives us confidence to put our trust and faith in him. We trust God's word with faith. We believe his promises and are confident of his love. Faith is a process of growth, following and relying on God himself. Faith changes us, our hearts and thoughts, and gives us hope and a future, as the Bible says. When we embrace faith and trust, we become confident of the future and have assurance about those things which we don't even see yet. And we're reminded by something that in the darkest nights, cling, that word cling, hold on, clutch, hold on to the assurance that God loves you, that God always has advice for you, a path that you can tread and a solution to your problems, and you will experience that which you believe. God never disappoints anyone who places their trust in him. And so remember, the Lord is with you. The Lord will make a way where there seems to be no way. And remember those words from Scripture, and I'll close with those today. Proverbs 3, 5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, we do pray for that direction of to our path. We pray for light for our path. We pray for more and more faith each and every day. We pray for a faith that will triumph over those daily little disappointments that confront us and seem to overwhelm us. We just put them behind us and we say we're moving forward with Christ. Be with us this day and in this week ahead. Amen. This time, Chris is coming forward and he's going to bring us our final closing hymn of praise.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Well, it's good to have been with you, and let's pray for God's blessing as we part for today. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace, even that peace of the Lord Jesus Christ which passes all understanding. And may it keep your hearts and minds in him. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and abide with you, now and forever. Amen. Until we meet again, God bless you all.